start all over again. Welcome. Welcome to everybody on live feed and Facebook. This coming week is Christmas week, so we have Christmas Eve program practice, Quincy says, from 5 to 5:30,
yes.
Right? Okay. Christmas caroling will start at 5:45, and the program will be at 6, right, everybody? So that's on Friday evening. Saturday morning is Christmas Day, so we will have service at, that's at 9:30, right? Service at 9:30 with communion. And a reminder about next Sunday, there will be church at 10, but no Sunday school for anyone. So those are the announcements on that. I got another thing here on, I've been noticing in the last several weeks. The church books closing on December the 31st. If you have a bill you haven't turned in or an offering you wish counted in 21, give it to the treasurer. And the same thing for anybody about bids or on the different contractual services. So kind of keep that in mind, turn some of that into council. So I'm going to continue my thing that I started last week about Santa is, or but Jesus is better than Santa. Santa has a belly like a bowl full of jelly. Jesus has a heart full of love. Santa offers ho, ho, ho. Jesus offers health, help, and hope. Santa says, you better not cry. Jesus says, cast all your cares on me, for I care for you. Santa's little helpers make toys. Jesus makes new lives, mends hearts, repairs broken homes. Santa may make you chuckle. Jesus gives you joy. Santa puts gifts under your tree. Jesus became our gift and died on a tree. So there's no comparison. Jesus is the reason for this season. I've got, Brandy has some things she's going to do for the parish ed.
Well, we have three young guys who have learned and memorized the Lord's Prayer. So if I could have Jackson and Levi and Alex come up. We have just some little certificates for you, and just congratulations on working hard and staying in the Word of God. So, I told them they didn't have to do it in front of you, but I probably should have just made them do it.
Thank you.
hear our praise and worship this morning to you. In your name, amen.
The fourth candle is called the angel candle or the love candle. It was the angel Gabriel who brought good news of Jesus' birth to Mary. On the wings of an angel came the message of peace on earth and goodwill to men. Christ's birth was like a bright lighthouse shining its light, piercing the dark night. Luke chapter 1, 26-33. Now in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph, of the descendants of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And came in, he said to her, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was very perplexed at this statement, and kept pondering what kind of salutation this was. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall name him Jesus. And he will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. And he will reign in the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom will have no end." Please light the candle. Dear Jesus, in whom I trust, you are our beloved Savior. We are grateful this morning for the angels who brought the message of your coming. We are even more grateful for what the message was, the message of you, and a God who was born as a baby who would grow into a God-man, and a God-man who saved us all from the sting of sin and death. Christ, we praise you. Hear our praise to you and know that we love you. Peace be with us. Amen.
The call to worship is found in Psalm 80, 1-7. Hear us, O Shepherd of Israel, you who lead Joseph like a flock, you who sit enthroned between the cherubim, shine forth between Ephraim, Benjamin, and Manasseh. Awaken your might and come and save us. Restore us, O God, make your face shine upon us that we might be saved. O Lord Almighty, how long will your anger smolder against the prayers of your people? You have fed them with the bread of tears. You have made them drink tears by the bowlful. You have made us a source of contention to our neighbors and our enemies. They mock us. Restore us, O God Almighty. Make your face shine upon us that we may be saved. Will you join us and we sing King of Kings and then Come Thou Fount? majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. From the mouth of children and infants, you have ordained a praise on account of your adversaries to silence the enemy and the avenger. When I behold your heavens to work of your fingers, the moon, the stars which you have set in place, what a man is that you are mindful of him, or the son of man that you care for him. You made him a little lower than the angels. You crowned him with glory and honor. You made him ruler of the works of your hands, and you placed everything under his feet, all sheep and oxen, and even the beasts of the field, the birds of the air, and the fish of the sea, all that swim the paths of the sea. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth.
Come out of every blessing.
if this be your sincere confession, and if with penitent hearts you earnestly desire the forgiveness of your sins for the sake of Jesus Christ, God, according to his promise, forgives you all your sins. And by the authority of God's word, by the command of our Lord Jesus Christ, I can declare to you that God, through his grace, has forgiven all your sins. In the name of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. Call on the scripture reader at this time.
First reading is from Micah chapter 5, verses 2 through 5. But you, O Bethlehem Ephrathah, who are too little to be among the clans of Judah, for you shall come forth from me, one who is to be ruler in Israel, whose coming forth is from of old, from ancient days. Therefore he shall give them up until the time when she who is in labor has given birth. Then the rest of his brothers shall return to the people of Israel, and he shall stand and shepherd his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God. And they shall dwell secure, for now he shall be great to the ends of the earth, and he shall be their peace. When the Assyrian comes into our land and treads in our palaces, then we will raise against him 7 shepherds and 8 princes of men. Epistle lesson is from Hebrews chapter 10, verses 5 through 10. Consequently, when Christ came into the world, he said, "Sacrifices and offerings you have not desired, but a body have you prepared for me. In burnt offerings and sin offerings you have taken no pleasure." Then I said, "Behold, I have come to do your will, O God, as it is written of me in the scroll of the book." When he said above, you have neither desired nor taken pleasure in sacrifices and offerings and burnt offerings and sin offerings. These are offered according to the law. Then he added, "Behold, I have come to do your will." He does away with the first in order to establish the second. And by that will we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. Here ends the readings.
Please rise for the reading of the gospel text if you are able. The gospel text today comes from Luke chapter 1, verses 39 through 45. Reading in Jesus' name. And in those days, Mary arose and went with haste into the hill country to a town in Judah. She entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. And when Elizabeth had heard the greeting of Mary, the baby leapt in her womb. And Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. And she exclaimed with a loud cry, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb." And womb, not the underwear. "And why is this granted to me, that the mother of my Lord should come to me? For behold, when the sound of your greeting came to my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy. And blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment in what was spoken to her from the Lord." Here ends the reading. Let us continue by confessing our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated on the right hand of God the Father Almighty, from where he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. We'll call on the children at this time for the children's message. Did you pick it out yourself? Are you excited?
No, you didn't. You had help. Who helped you? You don't know? Oh, you helped him, huh? Which, did she say, "Don't tell him I helped you"? No. So, what is this? Yeah.
Giraffe.
And this one's good catch on that first base, right? Because you were playing first base, right? And then after you made that catch, would you go, good job, Glove? Glove, you did a good job. I'm so glad you were with me. Oh, man, I couldn't have done it without you. So we don't do that, right? You guys like to garden? You go out in the garden and you're pulling weeds?
Yeah.
I had to work on a vehicle this weekend, and my hands hurt. I get neuropathy and pain in my hands, and I have to wear a glove, and I almost was thankful I had gloves on this weekend. But the reality is, can God use any one of us to do any one task? And you know what? We're not perfect. He's going to use us, and he puts his hand in there, and what he's going to find is, you know what? Our head is full of stuffing. And it's really hard to use our mouth because there's no way to get in there. Some of us are more stuffing, stubborn than others, aren't we? But can God use us nonetheless? What's one of the most stubborn animals on the earth? Reckon's dog? A raccoon? What would you guys say? There you go. Donkey. A donkey. Donkeys do not like to obey. They want to do what they want to do and what they want to do only. Did you know that God used a donkey to speak? He used a donkey to speak one time. To speak to King, I think it's Ahab, right? Where's my, I'm trying to remember now. I'm really bad at the Bible. No, so the thing is that if God can take and use the most stubborn animal there is, and in fact, he said, you know what? You know, another thing he says is that if these people wouldn't praise me, and this is on the day when everybody's coming into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday, he says, you know what? If they wouldn't praise me, then these rocks would cry out. You can't get much more stubborn than a rock. And if God can make a rock cry out, do you think he could use you? That's right. We believe and we know and we have faith that God's ability goes beyond our ability. No matter how much stuffing is in our head and how little mouth we have to use to work with, God can still use us. What do we need then?
Faith.
Faith? Just faith? Should we have faith in faith? Got to be in something, otherwise we're just having faith in faith, and faith in faith is faith in nothing. Faith in, oh, there we go, faith in Christ. Ready? Arms out. Good job. Arms out, arms together. Lord God, thank you. Thank you for belief. Thank you for this season where you went beyond what we could ever think or ask or do. You accomplished the unbelievable. You've brought in salvation unto men. We have hope because of you. Lord God, may it be that we rest in you and your ability and not in our own. May it be that we walk in faith. May that faith be granted us unto us by you, for we can't create it in ourselves by ourselves. We need you, O Lord, and your word. In your holy and precious name, amen. Don't go anywhere. 1 second. Name? You got to pick somebody. Did you forget?
Me.
Don't do one of my kids. What? How about Alex?
Yeah.
Alex, you're good? We good? Okay, you guys can go sit. Good job. Thank you.
This is the third sermon I've written this week, and the second sermon on love that I've written this week. I was not able to sleep last night, and at about 3 o'clock, I finally decided that the Lord had yanked on me enough, and I got up and rewrote the sermon for today, what I believe that he wants you to hear this morning. I believe that this sermon will anger some people. I was extremely convicted in it myself. I think it's going to be unpopular. I don't think it's the type of sermon that will anger you as if I had jumped out over the top of the pulpit, but I'm sure there might be frustration in it nonetheless. Often scripture is the unpopular thing, however. All I ask this morning is that as you listen, you recognize that God longs for you to hear and to be fed from the word today. And that if something strikes you and frustrates you, even angers you, that you don't stop listening. Listen until the end, if you would, please. The message text today is based from Philippians chapter 2, and it's verses 1 through 11, section of scripture that we probably are all very familiar with. The word of the season for today's message is love, centered on the love candle. There's so much to be said about love, about God's love. So many ways to describe it, so many ways we can talk about it. But today, I believe God wants you to hear from this text. So I begin Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 through 11 from the New American Standard. Therefore, if there is any encouragement in Christ, if there is any consolation of love, if there is any fellowship of the Spirit, any affection and compassion, make my joy complete by being of the same mind, maintaining the same love, united in spirit, intent on one purpose. Do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit, but with humility of mind, regard one another as more important than yourselves. Do not merely look out for your own personal interests, but also for the interests of others. Have this attitude in yourselves, which is also in Christ Jesus, who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a bondservant and being made in the likeness of man. Being found in the appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Please pray with me. I fear your words, Lord. And I fear not obeying you. I know I do not stand alone in this message you ask me to speak. We all long to hear from you. And so may it be that, O Lord, that is spoken. Not my words, but yours. Your voice ringing loud, speaking truth, opening hearts and creating faith. May it not be that we only hear, but today may it be, Lord, that we are stirred in our souls, stirred and encouraged and strengthened unto movement of foot, and heart. Thank you, Lord, for being faithful, so faithful to me and so faithful to us. In your precious name, amen. I begin with a question. Begin with a question. As believers, as fellow believers in Christ among the church united of all believers, but also as this very congregation, why are we allowing ourselves to be divided? Why is it that it seems when we look around at our behavior in the present day that we as Christians are being so unloving? I think of that in relation to things like wearing a mask. Things like that are on that present agenda. Why do we allow ourselves as Christians to say things like, I understand why you would wear a mask, but you are fearing COVID more than God? Why would we say such things? Have we forgotten that our words hurt other people? Have we forgotten that there's a world beyond ourselves? I ask the question, is that statement real? Because I've heard this very statement all too often in the public, even among ourselves. That people who choose to wear a mask, people who choose to get vaccinated, have feared COVID more than God. I'm not sure that that's really a fair statement. Because if that is a fair statement, then each and every single one of us in this room is guilty. Because each and every single one of us in this room has taken a medication at some point in time to help us with some kind of ailment. I mean, think about it in relation to cancer. Would we say to a cancer patient, if you go get help and get medicine for cancer, that you fear cancer more than you fear God? If we said that, wouldn't we feel foolish? Isn't God the same over both? While one says, I will not get vaccinated, I will not allow my freedoms to be taken from me, and so I will not wear a mask because that is my freedom. And because I fear God, that's who I rest in. And yet, is it not the same thing for the person who says, I will get vaccinated? If the vaccination is going to kill me, then so be it. I leave that to God. So therefore, God is the same God over those who are vaccinated and those who are unvaccinated. The ones who wear masks and the ones who don't wear masks. Because no sparrow falls from the sky unless God says so anyway. So why do we allow ourselves to judge one another? To say things that scar and that hurt. Verse 3 and 4 of our text. Do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit, but with humility of mind, regard one another as more important than yourselves. This cannot be stressed or said enough in today's society. Regardless of COVID or not, we are a selfish nation. We are a selfish people. It takes intention to become selfless. It takes love, because the act of love is that selflessness, acting on the other person's interest and not your own. I really didn't want to give this message. Is it possible that wearing a mask can actually be an act of love? Could that be possible? Paul would say that even though he felt the freedom to eat whatever he so chose and that all things were beneficial, that he would abstain from eating meat in front of somebody who didn't want to eat meat for the sake of the gospel. Why is it so hard for us? Why can't we put on humility? Why can't we put on humility for the others that we love around us? For those that are our friends, for our family, for our neighbors? Why can't we put them above our own opinion? Why is my own opinion and the exacting of that opinion into the situation more important than how somebody else feels? How I'm able to relate to that person? Why is my opinion more important? If we love someone and we want them to be present with us, right here, right in this sanctuary. Some of us say we need to invite people to come in here. And yet there are maybe some who would feel uncomfortable coming here because we refuse to wear a mask. But are we concerned with how they feel as much as our concern with self-gratification to invite somebody in? Or maybe in our home, maybe in our get-togethers. If we love someone and we want to be near them, we want them to be with us, we care that they are around us, but they feel more comfortable if we wear a mask. Is it really that hard that we should wear a mask for the sake of love? I don't really believe that everybody that gets the vaccination and that wears a mask fears COVID more than God. I do not believe that for one second. But you know, for the sake of just thinking of this idea, what if they did fear it, really? Maybe they have a right to fear it. Should we love them less because they fear it? I'm going to give you an example. Do you have a dog or a cat now or in your past, or maybe you even know of one that is scared of lightning and thunder? That when lightning and thunder come, they run under the bed. Now imagine that cat or dog is outside. They're an outside dog. And it begins to storm, thunder, and lightning. Should they fear? Well, I would hope so, because if you get struck by lightning, you're not able to fear anymore, right? You're dead. So they do have justice in some of their fear, placed well or misplaced. Would you walk to the back door as that dog claws to get in? In its extreme state of fear, would you
open the door and then kick at them and say, stop it, you got nothing to be afraid of. Stay outside, you're gonna be fine. And then shut the door. I can't imagine one person in this entire room treating a cat or a dog that way. In fact, what would happen would be you would open it. You would bring them in. You would towel them off. You would put them in your lap and you would cuddle them as they trembled. And you will say to them, it's going to be all right. You don't have anything to fear. You'll be okay. But you wouldn't say that as you kicked at them and kept them outside in the rain and the lightning and the wind. So why is it that we can imagine, or I can imagine, that we would treat a cat or a dog often better than those believers who have chosen, for whatever reason it might be, just or unjust, fear or not fear, to wear a mask or to get vaccinated? Why are we allowing ourselves to be divided? Here's a question, maybe a little overused. What would Christ do? What would Christ do for the sake of the people? If he was entering Peter's mother's house to have dinner with them, and it would be that he wore a mask, that more people might come or that they would feel comfortable, do you think he would wear a mask? If it was the law to be in the square or in the temple, that you would have to wear a mask, do you think he would wear a mask? He paid his taxes. Do we really think it's that hard to wear a mask? Let's talk about how hard it is. Let's talk about giving up rights. Verse 5. Have this attitude in yourself, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a bondservant and being made in the likeness of man. The ultimate love that we see here, that we celebrate this season, of Christ coming in my place to do what I could not do, giving up all of the things that he was for me, being found in the appearance as man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. How hard really is it to wear a mask? What did Christ ever do that was wrong? Not one thing. Let me ask you a question. Did Jesus ever fight for his rights? Let's think about it. Nope. He fought for your righteousness. That's what he fought for. He didn't fight for his rightness. Did Jesus ever once complain? Whip after whip after whip. Nope, no complaint. Giving up, coming as a baby, being clothed and wearing humanity. You think it's hard to wear a mask? Try wearing humanity when you're a god. I know. I know. I know. I understand what you're thinking and what you're feeling. I know. We are frustrated with being forced to do the things that we don't want to do. We're frustrated with the idea that we have to give up freedoms that we don't want to give up. And I would stand next to anybody and fight for my freedoms. But should we not fight for the love of the freedom also of the person next to us that we love? Why do we complain and whine about wearing a mask and judge the people who do? Because they chose differently than our own opinion. Jesus didn't have it as easy as just simply wearing a mask. He wore a cross. He wore our shame. Our shame. Where would we be in our salvation if Jesus treated us the way we are treating each other in regard to COVID and vaccination and masks? Where would we be? What a hopeless estate our salvation would be if we did not have a Savior who would put aside all selfish, all self, and become selfless. That he would empty himself, that he would be humbled. I do not believe, and I do not think, and I am not asking you to go put on a mask everywhere you go, or to go get vaccinated if you don't feel comfortable for it. That's not the point. The point is of what we are allowing ourselves to become one with one another, and what we would not give up for the sake of our own rightness and our own opinion, and what we would say to defend such opinion. We do not get to trample other people in our parade of rightness. We do not have the right to say things that should not be said. For the sake of being nice, we should keep them in our head and don't say them at all. For the sake of loving somebody else above ourselves. To think of how Christ has treated us, when, where, and how we should be treated. Oh, how he has loved us. We have no right to treat anyone any differently than he has treated us. What I ask for you today, or at least I pray that you would do, is remember how much Christ loves you. What he gave. The amount of what he gave. What he didn't exact in all forms. To know how much you mean to him and how much he's loved us. And I would ask, please, stop being divided. By your mercy, Jesus, and by your grace, we move and we rest. Amen.
Will you join us as we sing, All Is Well?
All is well, all is well.
Lord, I stand before your cross, in front of your manger and at your altar, fully aware that there is no other source, there is no other thing, that there can be hope, where love and joy can be found, where peace can be entered. There is no other answer. Heal our nation. Strengthen the faith and membership of our congregation. May love be what unites. First and foremost, your love for us, and then your love, Lord, as we love others, as you love others through us. And be with those who are sick and who are ailing, who are in our hearts and minds, that we long would be better in their health. Be with Lynn's mother. Be with those who are shut in. Be with Joanne. Be with Francis. Be with many others, O Lord. Be with the youth of this nation. And if you don't come before they become our leaders, then make them strong in you, O Lord. May they ever walk in you. May you always walk before them. That this nation might be greater and wonderful, better for them than it is in this moment for us. Though it is great, and I am grateful. I lift up the leadership of this church to you, O Lord. Thank you that they served. I pray that you would bless them. And soon we will get news for the upcoming year. Prepare them, Lord, that you would call, that you would have. May our future, because of you and your grace and justice, be bright. May it be filled with hope and believing. We rest in you in all ways. So we rest also in how you've taught us to pray. Now, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom and the power. Please rise and receive the benediction. We conclude this service in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen. Let us sing together our closing song.